Hi guys, Luton here, back with another episode of I'm No Philosopher. So today I wanted to cover something that I guess I have come to realise over the past week, and that sometimes it's good to take a step back and look at yourself and what it is that you're doing. And so what triggered this for me? What was I thinking about? Well, it was actually when I saw people commenting on YouTube about the statement EA released way back on December the 4th about DICE not working on DLC until the game was fixed. And before we go on, let me just read actually those words to you. I've got them here. And it says, "First, we want to thank the fans out there that are playing and supporting us with Battlefield 4. They say that we know we still have a ways to go with fixing the game. It's absolutely our number one priority. The team at DICE is working non-stop to update the game, and since Battlefield 4 China Rising expansion pack was already in the final stages of development by the time issues began with Battlefield 4, we decide to fulfill our promise to deliver it this week, but we're not moving on to future projects or expansions until we sort out the issues with Battlefield 4. We know many of our players are frustrated and we feel their pain. We will not stop until this is right." Now, I do believe that they actually made like a follow-up statement because there were some negative consequences when they posted that out there. I actually searched for it, but I couldn't find it, but I think they made some kind of like statement saying, "Oh no, no, actually it's going to be okay, we're going to do this, we're going to do that." But regardless, the result of it was that EA's stock took a hit from saying that investors were not impressed. But what I was unimpressed by though, was the fact that I saw this as nothing more than a publicity stunt to try and appease people and the players at the time, and as you guys will remember, while other producers were decreeing that this was the end of Battlefield 4 DLC, I stated that not only was Second Assault essentially already completed, but this statement didn't really even make any sense. Why would DICE have to stop working on DLC? The company staff had been designated, as with any company, to work on specific tasks. It doesn't make any sense that some areas would just stop working. Why? It wouldn't help the process of fixing the game. It didn't make any sense. What would have made more sense would be to sort of, I don't know, like hire temporary staff to expedite that repairing process. So I really didn't believe or understand the worth of this statement, and frankly it kind of pissed me off because it felt very much like slapping a temporary solution onto a more serious injury. So let's fast forward to the 16th of February, and this is where we now see Naval Strike coming out right off the back of Second Assault. But is the game fixed? Well, as you guys know, I've not really had any serious problems compared to some of you, and I feel really frustrated for people that are having to put up with the worst issues across all of the platforms. And yet since the latest small update for me, and other people as well, we've seen the issues, they even get worse, okay? So things have been quite stable for me lately until this update, and since then, I've had like multiple serious crashes, like really serious crashes. I had to go into Task Manager to close it down, so essentially like complete system freeze. And as well as that, we're still seeing the general issues with netcode latency, and it's all continuing on. But this today, it's not about EA or about DICE, it's about me. And how this whole development has left me feeling about myself as a producer and as a commentator. Now, it's pretty clear that from that EA statement and then the current releasing of two DLC after one another, that what's said and what's happening, you know, what's said and what happens are two different things. Now, this might seem like a pretty blindingly obvious statement to make, I guess, but stay with me on it, okay? So, at this time, I'm sure many people are feeling pretty frustrated, angry, or like me, somewhat disillusioned. But was I over-optimistic? Well, I regularly get told that I'm a Battlefield fanboy or a DICE apologist and much worse. It does grate on me a little bit. I've always thought of myself as an objective person, and that was one of the main foundations of my YouTube channel. It was for me to give my straight opinion, and I've always had a strong dislike for people who don't just tell things as they are. And anyone who knows me in real life would know that that's the kind of person I am. I don't have time for whispering behind backs or wasting time. People should just say what they mean and then not dance around the subject. Nothing makes me more irritated than that. Now, I believe that I have and still do stick with my principles. It's really important to me. And my predictions about news or other title releases, they're usually pretty on par. If we think back to my predictions about Medal of Honor, you guys remember, I didn't get on board with that game. I didn't get on board with Medal of Honor because I thought it was going to be balls, And it pretty much was. It came out on par. It had all the issues that I thought it would have. They hadn't sort of expanded on what they'd done previously in terms of kind of making the game better. And so overall, you know, many people were like, oh, it had so much potential, blah, blah. But it didn't. Yeah, it fell on its face, okay? And then you come to the concerns I have about Titanfall, right? About not having a long lifespan and being potentially too repetitive. And that's something we can't know entirely yet, but I've seen many people agree, not just on here, but on other channels as well, putting out those same concepts, that same kind of feeling about it. But when it comes to Battlefield 4, my arguably over-optimistic attitude, I now believe was misplaced. And to expand on that requires me to open myself up a little bit, which is something that I try to do as little as possible on YouTube. It's not really my kind of deal, and those of you that know me on Looting Gaming on my second channel will know that I'm much more open there. I'm a bit more kind of fun and blah, you know, because it's a different thing over there, and I try to be kind of interact with people a bit more personal, because it's kind of a different thing. So as a person, I'm generally quite highly cynical, like almost laughably so. In my experience, finding people or products that are reliable is a really hard thing to come by, and I really value it though. You know, if I find something that works, or if I find a product or a kind of service that works, I often try really hard to give them positive feedback, you know. So you might see a bit of a trend here that, like, if I feel there's something that's worth my time investing into, I go out of my way to give positive feedback. The main reason being is that most people don't give positive feedback for things, like, ever. In fact, actually, I remember one company that I'd had an issue with, a lot of, like, ongoing issue with something. And then when I actually found someone who was dealing with me well and so on and so on, I had to speak to a manager, and when she called me back and I spoke to her and I said, oh, and this person whose name I specifically took gave me really good help and they did this and this. And she said, oh, she said, that's so refreshing. Thank you so much for this. We'll make sure that person, you know, gets a little commendation and blah, blah, blah. And she said, we never get that kind of feedback. And I said, I know, that's why I'm giving you this feedback. And so you can kind of see that that's sort of perhaps my perspective, and I still do that, you know. So if I really try to seek products and things that work well. Nothing annoys me more. Okay, fantastic example, just to kind of name drop something right here, Seagate. Now I know, okay, that everybody has different issues, and with hard drives it's always something that's going to kind of you know, be kind of hit and miss. Some people will have one or a couple of drives that will never have any issues, and they'll just go on and on like tanks, okay? Some people might buy a drive and it burns out in a week, a month, and then the next one does the same and the same and the same. But the thing that really pissed me was that I had a couple of drives, basically. One failed, got a new one. Within like 6 months, that one was making pretty bad noises. What super annoyed me was that when I tried to get in contact with them, they made it extremely difficult to do that. And then when I actually did get to speaking to someone, they were so patronizing. You know, I was saying like, yeah, I've had a lot of hard drives, I know it. And he was like, oh, you do know they make kind of sounds and maybe it's that. And I was like, yeah, no, it's not that. And then even worse, what I found out was, okay, you send it off, and if it has a fault, if they deem it to have a fault, they don't, they're sort of, customer principle was, or you know, their sort of statement, it was like they don't even replace with a brand new one, they will give you a refurbished hard drive. What the hell is that? Anyway, a little off topic, but it was kind of trying to sort of get to the point of how it's important to me to sort of find things, and when I feel like I've got on board with something, to sort of back it and give support if I deem it to have the value to do so. And so finding products that are reliable, it's a very hard thing to come by. That's another good reason why I'm quite lucky. I've got an awesome dentist and mechanic. Those are two things you really want. But I generally approach things with a prove what you say attitude. And so why was I so optimistic and forgiving towards Battlefield 4 in the first months? Well, first of all, because one thing, it's very easy, as I say, to rant and hate. It's the easiest thing in the world to do, to just go, rah, 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 it sucks, it's broken, la, la, la. Okay, even in a very constructive way, to break something down and just go through the kind of negative aspects of it, that's still quite easy, rather than to sort of put it together within the context of like an entire product. If you just nitpick all the little bits and pieces, there's nothing difficult about doing that. Anybody can do that. And to do so early on with any situation, it's not really a very productive thing to do, not early on anyway. And that could be with a product, with customer service, it could be the way the person treated you, or perhaps just your own expectation. But it's later, when your patience has expired, that's the time when it comes to putting the hammer down and say, no, enough. and that's really where I find myself today. Now, in the early stages, the game was shown and stated to be kind of pushing the boundaries, but retaining the core values. These were all good things. Also, if you think about Battlefield 3, it had its issues, but we never suffered the same level of problems that many people would go on to experience in Battlefield 4, so it was unlike other titles in that, in many ways, the issues that came around were largely, I guess, unexpected. Now, next, I have to mention my trip to Stockholm. It's kind of part and parcel of this. This was for the Battlefield 4 reveal. Now, this was undoubtedly an amazing experience, and one that I will not forget, but it was not the experience of going there that left me feeling I owed EA or DICE anything other than doing what I had always done, which was being a producer in the way that I knew how to. Now, off the back of that, I also started getting a lot of comments, like straight away when I came back, a lot of comments from people stating that my happiness and my sort of anticipation for the game, I was just, you know, I was happy because I'd got to meet sort of people that I idolized, you know, it was a wonderful experience. And so, yeah, I started to get people simply, you know, they've been sort of saying things like, oh yeah, EA paid you off, or paid you to do this, paid you to do that. Straight away, you start getting this stuff. And I never had experienced comments of that nature before, and it really surprised me. And the day that a company puts words into my mouth is seriously the day that I would quit YouTube. It's just, like I said before, my principles and me as a person, that is just not me, and the day that that would happen, I would seriously just walk away. If it was not something that I felt had value or that I truly believed in, that's just, no, there's just no point in it, you know. Now, you guys will all be aware of the issues in the past month as well regarding the Ronku program for EA, and I didn't make any statement on that topic either, because I discussed with Level Cap, and he had his post that he made onto Reddit, and also Jack Frags had made a really amazingly good video about that. It said everything that needed to be said, and my input would have only been repetition. So I'd say if you've not seen those, go and hunt them down, and they tell you basically everything you need to know. But the long and the short of that whole issue is that people read what they really wanted to read into those situations, and also many news sites simply made very inaccurate claims. They kind of sort of read it a bit and they didn't really get it. We were never paid to say specific things. We were simply given vague outlines of the topics for videos, like, you know, make a video talking about Levolution, make a video talking about X or this and that, and you'd go, okay, I've got some footage that I could use, and I guess I'll talk about this. That's basically all it was, and it was a great opportunity for all the producers. But getting back now onto the topic of my conclusions and evaluation running through the release period, it unfortunately led me to see that I was not only wrong in some statements I'd made, I should have been far more cautious, but I also deceived myself, which is the most frustrating thing of all. And I feel kind of just, I still, even now, I feel kind of pissed off with myself, you know, it just irritates me. There's a general attitude on the net, okay, for people to never admit when they're wrong. It's seen, I guess, as weakness or backing down, but I don't see it that way. I actually see it as a strength. It's important for yourself and for the people you engage with to see you for who you are and as a person who can stand up and admit when they called it wrong. It's more important to me, myself, though, because it allows me to learn and make better judgments in the future. That's something that I've always seen. I mean, you learn from your mistakes. Everybody knows that. It's pretty straightforward. So, I guess, where did I go wrong exactly? Well, let's go back again to Stockholm. And while we were there, we were shown tests and development processes for the game, and we went into different sort of, meeting rooms, sort of conference rooms, and explained to in detail the development, the premise, the structure of the game. Now, if you think back to my breakdown of the Frostbite 3 engine, which is some on my channel still, pretty good views actually on that one, and that video was possible from the notes I made at the event, because I had my iPhone and I capped like audio, and then I came back and I broke it down. All right, so I did quite a lot of work there with that stuff, and after this we got to mix and then discuss informally with DICE developers, which was not just enjoyable, it was very informative. And as I've told many times, I was lucky to have the opportunity to interview at length both Carl Magnus and Lars Gustafsson, who are pretty much like the fathers of DICE and Battlefield. These experiences were just invaluable to me technically, and they shaped my point of view towards understanding what DICE and the people who work there, what it's all about. So all of this left me feeling very positive and optimistic, certainly. But think about it, why not? Why not feel like that after you've had that experience? And when we were looking at the stuff on paper, it all sounded great, and it's not just from a hype point of view, but also from like a human personal perspective, because when you meet and discuss with people, you get a different feeling about the title you're going to see. So you might think I'm about to launch into a woeful sort of anti-DICE tirade, but I'm not, because no matter how the release of Battlefield 4 was and has been, the feeling of pride, success, innovation from the DICE staff that I'd spoken to and I've seen since talk is undoubtedly a true and genuine one from their part, okay? It's something that they put everything of themselves into, and they really do believe it, you know? And I say, you know, people can say whatever the hell they want to, but that's something that I know, and I know it's right as well. Now, this is why on one of my recent videos I made it clear to highlight the fact that I am absolutely certain that the staff at DICE are surely as frustrated by the way in which the game was released and then its subsequent fallout as we all are. So where am I going with this? Well, here's the thing. What I've tried to do is explain what I myself have been turning over in my head, why it was in the past few months I've tried to look positively to a situation that was, I guess, anything but. And especially when I generally am quite wary and standoffish about new titles. Also why I still try to remain optimistic. And although I've been more forgiving than most, I feel that there was a good reason for this as well. So, for example, in the early stages of the release, there was a good amount of communication about fixes and updating. In the past, this was one of my major frustrations with bad releases, other titles, there have been many, okay. One of the main things, yeah, was the failure to interact with the community, and a lot of devs are not so good at this. I think it's becoming more and more ever prevalent now, but in the past, it was just, you know, here's the game, whatever, you know. I think it's turning around a little bit right now, and this was certainly true in Battlefield 3. You know, they really didn't do a very good job there of communicating, and from that to Battlefield 4 has been markedly improved. So I felt that it was a positive and constructive process, and progress was being made. And even if there were some serious problems from day one, that compared to other titles, I still felt that things were moving in the right direction. Now also, there was the simple fact that compared to other players, I simply didn't experience the same depth of issues that others did, and it's really hard to criticize something on problems that you have not really had extensively yourself. I did suffer crashes, netcode problems, hit recog, one-hit kills, and a lot of other weird bugs as well. But all of this, I was able to kind of brush off and just get back into the game. It wasn't really game-breaking for me, it was just kind of like, oh man, that's super annoying, oh well, get back in. You know, it kind of wasn't really sort of a killer for me. And so for the most part, my gameplay was, and still is, pretty enjoyable. Now, as I've said plenty, this past week, people can complain about the game all they want to. I keep saying this week because I just keep coming back to it. But what annoys me more is the player base, and the fact that it's very, very hard to find teams that have a balanced level of players and who have a decent understanding of where to move and what to do. But God, that's just a whole other topic that I could just talk for hours about, so okay, we'll leave that for now. So we have all experienced problems, and some perhaps more severely than others, maybe many more severely than others. But the other issue was that on testing some DLC at the events, as I've explained this before, myself and other producers have said that these things are nearly always held on a LAN setup, and that means we simply did not or wouldn't see many of those experiencing the kind of netcode issues. You don't see that kind of stuff because it's not happening. Again, this was part and parcel of forming my original perspective that I came into the title with. So an obvious question, I guess, would be, do I ever feel I misled other people about the game? And my answer to that would be never, okay? Everything I have ever documented about the game has been my own thoughts and opinion, and to me personally, that's why I feel from here on out, I'll be no longer so forgiving by default. As I said before, in reality, as a person, I'm far more cynical and cautious about people and experiences or products. But I have not held my usual caution to such strict conditions when it came to some of my YouTube content. So why? Well, perhaps because I just wanted my own expectations of Battlefield 4 and DICE to ring true. My predictions that the game would be patched quickly and with a high level of communication, it just didn't play out. And still, I felt though that on the whole I made a good analysis, as I did with Medal of Honor and lately Titanfall. And let's not forget that during the entire E3 livestream I was pretty much glued to that thing, and I was very active about assessing the content, breaking it down, and that's when we discovered also that tier reload. You remember the tier reload mechanic we discovered during that process, which was really fantastic to discover at that point in time. I was so happy about that. So this has been a bit of a downer, right? It's just me wallowing in my own frustrations. Well, I really don't see it that way, okay? And here's why. For me, this is an opportunity to look, to learn, and to not make the same mistakes in the future. So after all, as I often say in game, we learn the most from our mistakes. That's how you develop tactics. That's how you figure out how to get the most first server kills and to be one of the most powerful guilds on your server in World of Warcraft. And it's how you outplay your enemy in Battlefield, even if you're not the best shot in the game. The mind, the mind is the greatest weapon. But as I say this, I also think, isn't it a shame that we live in a time where you can't just trust people to do what they say they will, where we have to constantly be on our guard, assessing to like the nth degree. And perhaps Battlefield 4 was my last title of true optimism and expectation. I find it pretty funny as well that in posts on my channel people stated in the past that I was too harsh and critical, too negative even, and now I find myself at the polar opposite of that. But what killed it for me though, and I guess maybe what gave me a bit of a kick up the ass this week, was that statement just sticking in my head. A clear press release saying that DLCs would be on hold until the game was repaired and to an acceptable standard. I didn't buy it at the time, like I said, but to now have Second Assault and Naval Strike released in such close proximity, it just underlined for me and rubbed salt into the wound, and that, you know, what is said and done can't be held in the same regard. So taking stock of the situation right now, it feels quite cathartic actually to me, and I think this year is going to be an interesting one. Titanfall, I'm very interested to see how it fares. Part of me thinks that YouTube producers won't allow Titanfall to fail, simply because they need a new title to inject some energy into their channels. COD is dying a death as ever. Battlefield struggles on. But where will I end up this year? I honestly don't know. I don't put content onto YouTube as a career. I have my own full-time job. I don't do it for the money, you know, compared to, again, it just doesn't come in that way. I do it because I enjoy creating content. I do it because it allows me a medium for me to put forward my thoughts, ideas, and discussion. I've said that in the past. And I think the last thing I'll say is this. I remember over a year ago now, I was talking with another producer about how long videos and deep discussive content were a turnoff for subscribers. People don't want that. They want like some 5-minute video where it's like bam, bam, bam. I disagreed. I said, you're wrong. If you put it out there, then you will attract and develop an audience around that content. And that's what I have done. I have got like an amazing subscriber base. You guys are the core of the channel. And I know that you people watching to the end of this video right now are my absolute true subscribers. I see very often people commenting on my videos, but not about my videos, about the quality of the comments on the channel. And I find that amazing. I still work really hard. You know, I work hard to create, interact, and produce content for YouTube. And as long as I've got people to support me, I think for the foreseeable future, I'll continue to do that. Thanks for watching today, guys. And as always, value your comments. I've put myself out there a bit more than I usually would. So I hope you guys appreciate that. See you next time. This is Lootin'.